So let's get to obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. Now, these patients are really at the risk for developing episodes of apnea and desaturation postoperatively, and they definitely have an increased risk of pneumonia and respiratory failure. And you've really got to be careful with these patients. They've got to be assessed by the person who's going to administer the anesthesia, and postoperatively, best to put them in some place like a high care facility where you could monitor their breathing and at least monitor their saturation. So what can you do for them preoperatively? Now, there's some evidence that you could trial them on some preoperative spirometry, incentive spirometry. In other words, a little device that they get from the physiotherapy department. If you don't have those facilities, you can just try and create a little device. They just have to blow into it against resistance to improve all their lung parameters. Other things that you can consider, really improving their exercise status and ask them to lose some weight. Now, these two things are usually very difficult. There's perhaps not the time or the opportunity for them to do so. Fancier things that you can consider is just some continuous positive airway pressure device that they can sleep with the weeks prior to surgery, and also mandibular advancement devices. So how do we identify these patients? Well, there is a Berlin questionnaire, and you see the shortened URL. Visit that, you'll see a PDF of that questionnaire, and that'll identify for you the patients at risk of obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. The gold standard, though, is an overnight sleep test. Now, not all units have that test. It's not easy to send a patient for that test, but that certainly is the gold standard. So be aware of the patient with obstructive sleep apnea syndrome and take particular care of them. So overall, how can we improve the patient's chances, not only the sleep apnea patient, but all patients? Well, first of all, really think about this incentive spirometry preoperatively. There's a study that looked at patients with laparoscopic cholecystectomies. Some were randomized to nothing, and some were randomized to a week's worth of preoperative incentive spirometry, blowing against resistance for a week, a couple of times a day, just to improve their lung capacity and various lung indices. And there was a difference in outcome when it came to risk for postoperative complications. Other things is improving the nutritional status. That makes logical sense, I suppose, but just really looking at the evidence outside of cardiac surgery hasn't really been shown to make a difference. But of course, if there are problems with your patient, you can try and improve that. Cessation of smoking is the important one, and it's the period that's involved with that. A patient really has to stop smoking for 6 to 8 weeks at least prior to the surgery for there to be a lessening of the risk for postoperative complications. Finally, these risk calculators. Gupta et al. Did a lot of work. They looked at all the VA databases in the United States and then more recent complication databases, and they tried to look at the risk factors that were predictive of an increased risk of postoperative pneumonia and respiratory failure. And you'll see some of the factors that they found: type of procedure, the ASA class, the age, the existence of COPD, functional status, one we haven't mentioned before, preoperative sepsis, and then of course smoking. So visit www.surgicalriskcalculator.com. You can download some of those calculators as apps, or you can just use it online. You fill in that data and it gives you a risk of a patient developing, for the one calculator, pneumonia, for the other, respiratory failure. Now, we're not quite sure what to do with those, but at least it identifies for you the patient that is at risk so that you can monitor them better preoperatively, or perhaps think about those things that I mentioned. Do the incentive spirometry, for instance, but definitely take better care of them. It's a risk management in these patients. In the next lecture series, we're going to start looking at the diabetic patient.